time. I'm on time now. If you all would please come in and have a seat, Joey. Only because you're wearing pink. I'm wearing pink. If you didn't wear pink, you obviously didn't get the memo. Oh my gosh. So, anyway, it's good to see all your lovely faces. I hope you all had a wonderful Thanksgiving. If you didn't, I don't want to hear about it. See Nona. She wants to hear about it. You're like the counselor person, so if you want to cry, go see her. It's good to see y'all. Pastors aren't here again, but that's okay because we can do it without them. I said that. What do we have going on? Oh, I want to share something with you real quick. Something that happened over the weekend. My wife and I have been listening to these marriage CDs, and a guy said something that struck me. He said, God is not going to do by miracle what he expects you to do by obedience. And that hit me hard. And Sherry was like, well, what'd you think about it? And like, that's the one thing that stuck out to me more than anything else was that. Well, my car broke down, engine shot, and we were like semi-freaking out because I don't want to buy another car. But I didn't freak out. We prayed, and then we started looking for a new car. And then so we went down to San Antonio for Thanksgiving, and we narrowed it down to two vehicles. And on our way to go, I wasn't praying for a miracle. I was speaking in obedience because I'm commanded to walk by faith, and I'm told that I have favor, so I don't have to pray for it. I already have it. And so I was just exercising that as I was, you know, just kind of praying over everything that was going on. So wasn't asking God for a miracle. I was like, we're going to have favor. We're going to get this done, and we're going to get the best deal. And like just speaking those things that I knew to be true out. And so we go look at one car, and it's a newer car, and it's more expensive. And then we go look at the cheaper car that's older, and it's more beat up. And I told my wife to go get on the phone with the first dealership that had the nicer car. I'm like, you're a little bit more straightforward than me, and you always get what you want. So go get it. So I know where she's strong, and I know where I'm weak. So I'm like, go, just go. I believe in you. Just go do it. So she got on the phone with the first dealership we went to, and they basically matched the price of the older beat-up car. And we walked away with a great deal, and we walked away with favor, and it was a huge blessing. So, it listening to what that guy said, I wasn't expecting a miracle. I was expecting what I already have to, you know, to manifest. So, anyway, that was that. I just thought it was pretty cool. Announcements. This is what Pastor Ricky should do. Oh, my glasses. Okay. So, thank you. I really can't see out of them. They're my eyes. Baptisms on 12/11. If you have not been baptized, if you want to be baptized, or if you want to be redunked, let us know, and we'll make that happen for you. If you really don't know what baptism is, come find a leader, and we will sit down and we will go with you about the biblical principles of baptism and what it means and help you make a decision. And then also on 12/18, we will be having intro to the point. If you haven't gone or if you just don't want to go, please go. It's a time where the pastors will sit down with you, they'll feed you pizza, and they will share with you their hearts, the vision of the church, where it came from, where it's at now, and where it's going. And it's to help you feel connected to the body. It's not about just hearing what they have to say. We want you to know the inner workings and what the heart of the church is and what we're trying to accomplish. And then December 2nd is the youth. They are going on the trip to little town of Bethlehem. Where is that? Burn it. So if you want to get rid of your kid for an evening, you can send them with Joey and with Tiffany and just give them $10 for food and they'll take them away, and you can have an evening to yourself. Feed them a bunch of sugar and stuff that you wouldn't normally feed them, and just give, you know, they need patience, so that'll help them. that will bless them tremendously. Or just like give them a 6-pack of Monster Energy drinks and let them all have one. Yeah, it's good stuff. Don't listen to me. It's good. Royal Rangers is tonight from 6 to 7:30. If you have a child that is kindergarten through 8th grade, boy or girl, you can bring them. Royal Rangers basically is like Boy Scouts for church. They learn, they have devotion and Bible study, but they also do some pretty cool activities. They learn how to handle knives responsibly. We don't do guns in church, but they talk about weapon safety and all that stuff, and they have campouts and things of that nature. So if you want your child to be involved in that, then please bring them. And then December 4th is Missions Sunday. That is the one day out of the month where if you adopted a child from Peru, right? No. Dang it, Sri Lanka. I always get it wrong. Somewhere over there. That is when... I'm just going to say Peru, and y'all can, if I say Peru, you know Sri Lanka, and we'll all be good, because I'm going to keep saying Peru. Anyway, Mission Sunday, that's when your, I don't want to say your monthly due, but that's when your money you bring in, and it gets sent to the child. And then if you just want to give towards missions, you can do that as well. Also, that Sunday morning, we will have our first adult. Everyone say adult. Thank you. Adult Coffee and Donut Fellowship. If your kid goes and grabs a donut, we will chop their hand off. Greg will do that because he looks like he would do that. He won't do that. We're not really going to chop their hand off. But it's specifically for the adults. It'll be back in the corner over there by the kitchen. Come in, have a cup of coffee, eat a donut. It's just another opportunity for us to get connected, because sometimes when we come in here and we just sit, we don't want to talk. But go back there, talk. Drink some coffee, eat a donut, whatever you got to do. And then tonight, there is no Song of Solomon. And then they will be having the Overcomers class and the Financial Freedom class as well. So if you're in those classes, hold on, you have to be here. If you're in Song of Solomon, you're excused. If you're not and you're in those classes, be there. Yes. Who are you pointing to? We good? Okay. And then on December 17th, we are going to plan a youth / from what I've told they're now called Awesome Agers paintball trip. So basically, if you are ages from 10 to 37, you can go. I don't make the rules, brother. I just read them because I make them, because I can read them. So we're probably going to do it in the afternoon. It's really going to be the youth group and the Awesome Agers. And if you are a parent of one, then you can go, because we want to end up doing it kids against adults, because it's just fun to just shoot kids with paintballs. I said with paintballs. It's fun, because I have a 10-year-old boy, and it's a very stress reliever. Yes, I like that word. It's a stress reliever. Anything else? Am I missing anything? Oh yes, thank you. If you are in the Warriors, I'm gonna put these down. If you are in Warriors Way, Ashley wants to have a meeting with you over there right after church for about 5 minutes. And I would highly stress you not leave, because she will find you and hunt you down, and she will probably hurt you. Play in dance drama. Cool? Everyone hear that? Obviously you did. Anything else? No. All right. If you would, please give my lovely wife a hand. She is the nuggeteer for the day. And while she's doing that, if you would, please get your tithes and offerings ready as she begins. The ushers will come around and hand. hand out the baskets, and you drop your money in the baskets, and it goes in the other basket. And yeah, you get to pray over it, too.
Good morning. I like jokes and corny, witty sayings and dad jokes, stuff like that. A couple of weeks ago, my kids, they homeschool, so we practice public speaking, and their topic that they had to do was they had to memorize a joke and then tell it to their group. Well, my son got a joke book from the library, and he was reading through all these jokes, and some of them are really funny, but there were quite a few of them that were the same jokes from when I was a little girl that I've heard 5 million times, and they're not funny anymore after you hear them a million times. But a couple of the ones, like, for example, some of the corny ones that I really liked was, who is the shortest man in the Bible? Well, there was Bildad the Shuhite, or Nehemiah, but even smaller than them were the guys that fell asleep on their watch. So stuff like that is absolutely hilarious to me, and I love hearing jokes. I like, if you can say something in a way that's going to make me laugh, I love that. A couple of other things that I like, for example, I may look like I have it all together, but down inside my shoe, my sock is falling off. Little things like that. I love when people can twist and look at things with a sense of humor. But as I was thinking about it, I realized that as adults, we do the same thing with our lives, that our enemy is a jokester. He only has the exact same list of jokes that he's had since the beginning of time. The only things that he can do to us are the same things he's ever done. When we're young and when we're naive, we take his jokes and we take him seriously and we tell everybody about it. Like, for example, you're getting ready to go to work and you go out and your car won't start, or you spilled something all down the front of you right before a meeting and you let it ruin your day and you talk about it and you tell everybody about it. You call people, just like with a brand new joke. You can't wait to tell everybody about it. We need to get to the point where we realize that all it is a joke, and that a true joke is something that you can repeat and that will be funny whoever you tell it to. It's not something where you make fun of somebody, where you pick out something about somebody that they can't change and you tease them about it, and then you say, I was just joking. That's not a real joke. A real joke is something like those Bible ones where the shortest man in the Bible was Nehemiah. That's funny. It's a joke. But when something happens, whether it's God that allows it to happen or whether it's the enemy that does something to us, it's always God's plan or God's purpose. And as I was reading in Exodus, God was, it was a story about where the Israelites got the manna and the bread and the meat from heaven. And the purpose for that was God was testing them. He wanted to see what they would do with the command that he gave them and the circumstances that they had and the matter of their heart. He wanted to see what they would do with that. So as something happens to us, when God allows something, or whether we think it's the enemy that does it, whether it's our car won't start, or we spill something down the front of us, how do you respond to that? Do you let it ruin your day? Do you tell everybody about it? Or do you choose to let the joke be on him? Do you say, God, thank you so much for the fact that this car won't start, but it's in my driveway. You blessed me with that. Michael's car broke several times, and every single time that it happened and it had to be towed, it was from home. He wasn't out of town. It wasn't from Austin. It didn't break on the side of the road. It was always in our driveway or somewhere easy and convenient. And so instead of getting angry and letting it ruin our day, we were able to praise God. Thank you for your provision for this. Thank you that you have something better planned. Thank you. And it didn't ruin our day. So is the joke on you or is it on him? That's my question.
Amen. I'm glad she's my wife. She does a better job at that than me. Whatever. You're fired. All right. If you all would, please. That wasn't a joke. If you all would, please stand. This morning during intercessory prayer, there was a very loud resounding of victory. And victory isn't a miracle. Victory is something that we are told to walk in. And I think we forget that sometimes. We're praying for a miracle. And why are we praying for something that we already have and something that we're already supposed to do and something that we already are? And so if you have found yourself in a place that you're needing victory, you have to understand that you already have it, and you just have to start walking in it. And you have to start laughing at the enemy instead of allowing him to laugh at you. Because if you start laughing at him, he's going to be like, what are you doing? You're not. I'm supposed to be laughing at you while you're cowering and hiding and not going to church and not reading your Bible and not praying. You laugh at him and you say, hey, I already have it. It's mine, and this is what I'm going to do. So with that in mind, she's got a very, very, very appropriate song for this, Strike the Ground, on the Wells of Revival. Because we're not worried about what the enemy has planned. All we want to focus on is what God's going to do. So Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be united in one mind, one body, and one accord. And Father, we just pray over the tithes and offerings. We thank you for the abundance that is here now, and we thank you for the greater abundance that is coming as well. We ask that you bless it, that you multiply it, Father, that you help us to be good stewards over it in this house and in our own houses. And Father, we just pray as we come, that we come to worship you. We come to give you praises that you are due and that you are owed, and that we come with joyful hearts. And Father, I pray that if there be anything on anyone's mind that's distracting them, Father, that you just woo them in with your love and with your presence, that you come and minister to them individually, right where they're at, and that your goodness draws them to you, that they lose sight of all their problems and all their situations, and they just focus their heart and their intentions on you and watch everything else just fade away. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Y'all got to come up front. We're going to do In the River, then Strike. Sorry. He didn't know that originally it was. Okay, Richard, if you'll bring the volume up for me, Annie. Hey, special thanks to everybody who was able to help Lindy and Seth move this week, especially with Thanksgiving. I know that they're extremely grateful. And if you would please take the time to congratulate them on their new home. It's beautiful. God has really given them favor in every way. But just give them a little hug and tell them congratulations. But let's go ahead and get going.
There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain that drowns sorrows. There is an ocean deeper than fear, the tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The flood of heaven crashing over us. The tide is rising, rising. Tell them bursting.
Come on, there's a current. There is a current stirring deep.
spring up a well. Spring up a well in me. Nothing can stop this joy. We're dancing in the street. Spring up a well. Spring up a well. Spring up a well in me. Come on, say break open. Break open prison doors. Set all the captives free. Spring up a well. Spring up a well. Spring up a well in me. Nothing can stop this joy. Come on, sing it out. We're dancing in the street. Spring up a well. Spring up a well. Spring up a well in me. Oh, break open prison doors. Set all the captives free. Spring up a well. Spring up a well. Spring up a well in me. Nothing, nothing can stop this joy. We're dancing in the street. Spring up a well. Spring up a well, spring up a well in me.
Tell them bursting.
Bursting, bursting up from the ground. We feel it now. Bursting, bursting up from the ground.
We come alive.
We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive. We come alive. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive.
Come on, tell them again.
We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive.
Come on, sing it again.
We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive.
Tell it, break open.
Break open prison doors. Set all the captives free. Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well in me. Nothing can stop this joy. We're dancing in the street.
Come on, sing it out.
Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well.
Tell it, break open.
Break open prison doors. Set all the captives free. Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well in me.
Nothing,
nothing can stop this joy. We're dancing in the street. Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well in me.
We come alive in the river.
We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river.
Come on.
We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river.
strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Come on, do it again. Strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth.
Come on, do it again.
Strike the ground on the wells of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wheels of revival. Burst forth, burst forth.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness.
Come on.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies,
and we're raising up righteousness.
Come on, do it again.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness.
Do it again.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness.
There's a war going on in the heaven.
Come on.
Tearing down wicked principalities.
It's not just in the heavenlies, it's in this room this morning. Come on.
And we're raising up righteousness.
You sing it.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies. And we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies. And we're raising up righteousness.
Come on, sing it again.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies. And we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in
Stay
the
right
heavenlies.
Here, just keep going.
And we're raising up
righteousness. Come on, do it again.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness.
There's a war.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness.
Come on, raise it up.
And we're raising up righteousness. 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 And we're raising up righteousness.
Hearts are crying out, we need to see you now. Your kingdom come in power, sin.
Come on, sing it again.
Our hearts are crying out, we need to see you now. Your kingdom come in power, sin.
The ground on the wheels of revival, burst forth, burst forth.
Come on, every voice.
Strike the ground on the wheels of revival, burst forth.
Come
burst
on,
forth.
Sing it out.
Strike the ground on the wheels of revival, burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wheels of revival.
Come on,
burst forth. Burst
every
forth.
Voice in the house.
Strike the ground on the wheels of revival. Burst forth, burst forth. Strike the ground on the wheels of revival. Burst forth.
Come
burst
on, now
forth.
There's a war.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies,
and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness.
Come on, do it again.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up righteousness. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up.
Come on, there's a war.
There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're tearing down wicked principalities. There's a war going on in the heavenlies, and we're raising up
righteousness.
And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness. And we're raising up righteousness.
Our hearts are crying out. We need to see you now. Your kingdom come in power. Send the rain.
Do it again.
Our hearts are crying out. We need to see you now. Your kingdom come. Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory by the blood of the Lamb.
Come on, sing it with me.
I see Satan fall like lightning.
Come on.
I see Jesus lifted high.
Tell him fear can't stop us.
Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory by the blood of the
Lamb. I see Satan
fall
like
lightning. I see Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory by the blood of the Lamb.
The rain, send the rain, send the rain,
every tongue strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue.
Come on. There's a fight in this house. It's against this team doing any worship this morning. I can't hear a thing. The sound is going a little crazy. I need you to war with me. Come on. We're not here to be your cheering section. We're here to be one voice in Christ, screaming out, shouting and declaring and proclaiming to the world of who our God is. So I need you to be, it's group participation. And we're being attacked, so that means I need you to step up and be a soldier and help fight. I don't normally ask for help, but I'm asking you to help because it's rough. It's not always easy being on this side. And if I don't have the luxury of not coming in, then you don't have the luxury of not coming in. And if you're here, guess what? You picked up your mantle and you better get to fighting, because I can't swing by myself. Okay? So get your right hand. Get your right hand. Put your sword in it and start swinging this morning. Forgive me. I love you. I really do. But I'm getting my butt kicked and I could use some reinforcements. Can you help me? Okay, I see. I see Satan fall like lightning. I see Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory by the blood of the Lamb. Come on, do it again.
I see Satan fall like lightning. I see Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory
by the blood of the Lamb.
Come on, do it again.
I see Satan fall like lightning. I see Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory by the blood of the Lamb.
Come on, do it again.
I see Satan fall like lightning. I see Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory.
Come on, I can think we're doing it again. Come on.
I see Satan fall like lightning. I see Jesus lifted high. Fear can't stop us. Death can't stop us. We go forth in victory by the blood of the Lamb.
Tell him our heart.
Are crying
come
out.
On.
We
come
need
on.
To see you now. Your kingdom come in power. Send the rain.
Come on, cry out.
Our hearts are crying out.
We need to see you now.
Your kingdom come in power. Send the rain.
Send the rain.
Send the rain. Send the rain.
Send,
send the rain, send the rain, send the rain,
oh yes,
send the rain. tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground.
Come on, keep going.
Every tribe and every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe, every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain. Every tribe,
every tongue, strike the ground.
Come on, just keep singing it.
Every tribe and every tongue, strike the ground, bring the rain.
God's preparing us to be able to expect the unexpected. See, we come in here and we see the piano player not here, and we freak out because things aren't the way they normally are. It's unexpected. But I heard the Father say he's proud of you because you pushed through and you persevered and you stepped up and you laughed in the enemy's face because it was hard to push through because things aren't what we expected them to be. It wasn't the same sound that we expected. It wasn't the same way that we're used to. It was an opportunity to overcome. It was an opportunity to push through. It was an opportunity to meet the unexpected and welcome it and accept it and push forward. And that's what we're supposed to do, is welcome the unexpected, because if he's going to bring a new move of the Spirit, it's going to be in a way that we have not experienced before. It's going to be unexpected. I want you to focus your heart on not what they're doing, on the fact that there's not piano playing right now when usually somebody speaks. I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to hear the sound that heaven's making right now. And I want you to join in that sound and not worry about the sound that's coming off the stage. So, Father, we open our ears to hear your sound, to hear the sound that heaven is making right now. And, Father, we join in unison with that sound to bring you honor and to bring you glory. We relinquish the fact that things aren't the way we thought they would be. And we welcome the unexpected. We welcome a new move of the Spirit. And we just align ourselves with it. In Jesus' name.
Sing it. Come on, tell him chains. Sing it with him.
Chains are broken. Scales are on the floor. Truth is broken. I'm no orphan.
Come on, do it again.
Chains are broken. Scales are on the floor. Truth is broken.
on, you know it, sing it. Come on, tell him I'm alive.
I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive.
Come on, I'm alive.
I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive.
Come on, keep going.
Cause I'm alive.
Sing this again.
I am whole. He says I am. I am whole. He says I.
Come on, sing it again.
I am whole. He says.
Come on, I am all.
I am whole. He says.
Come on, keep going, sing this.
I am whole. He says I.
Come on, yes.
I am whole. He says I.
Come on, keep going.
I am whole. He says I am. I am whole. He says I.
Come on.
your praise will ever be on
my lips.
Ever be
on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on
your praise, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips.
Tell him
your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise.
Come on, tell him again.
Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on.
Come on, tell him.
Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.
For you will be praised. You will be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. Saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised.
Come on.
With angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints.
Worthy.
Come on, do it again.
Are you, Lord?
You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be.
Come on, sing it. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.
Come on, just tell him this again.
Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be,
come on, do it again.
Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be
on my lips.
Your praise will ever be.
Come on, finish strong.
Ever be. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will
ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
Lord, we do lift up your name on high. We praise you for who you are and what you do. We ask today, O God, according to your word, that as your people lift up your praises, that you will draw back the heavenly veil and grant us a glimpse of your majesty, your glory, that your enthroned presence would be made known in our midst, O God, that we might see you, know you better. Moreover, Lord, that you might have your will and your way in this congregation and these people today. Thank you for your loving kindness that's new every day, the mercy that you shower on us. And God, we pray in Jesus' name that today would be the salvation for some, that today would be the day of deliverance for others, that today would be the day that you meet provision for all of us who are so desperately in need of you and what you bring with you. So may you be glorified in our midst today, O God. May you be exalted in our praise. May our hearts be lifted up to push you higher in our lives. Give you the supremacy and the top place. Praise you, Lord. Give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I don't care. Thank you. Appreciate Michael for what he was saying earlier. I don't know about you guys, but do you praise any in your quiet time? That's a good thing to do. If you don't do that, if you need help with that, turn on some music, but you don't have to. You can praise verbally. It's what the angels do. They say their praise. And I don't know about you, but sometimes in my closet or when I want to lift up praise to the Lord, it's like pulling teeth, right? And yet he's plain in his word in Psalm 22:3, I think it is, or 23:2, one or the other. I haven't reviewed that one for a while, so I'm getting rusty. But that's plain in the scripture that says he is manifest, or his enthroned presence is made known in the midst of his praising people. And so if you need to draw near to God, there's no better way to do it than to usher in his presence and praise. And so what if it's like pulling teeth? Press. He may be resisting coming in and opening himself up to you to see how serious you are about it. You ever thought about it that way? The presence is needed, but the journey into presence is just as needed. Some of y'all don't track with that, so I'm assuming you've never had to struggle to get into his presence before. I had an interesting experience last night. It was kind of like this, trying to break into the presence of God, or have his presence break in on me, really, is what I was needing. We were watching TV, just kind of relaxing after Thanksgiving meal and family and visiting and all that kind of stuff in the afternoon. Went home that night, just kicked back, kind of relaxing, and catching our breaths and watching TV. And as I was sitting there, I began to feel weird. And I was thinking back, what did I eat that would make me feel this way? And it wasn't anything that I ate that made me feel this way, but I started feeling kind of uncomfortable. Not like you're tired uncomfortable, it's an uncomfortable, like almost like an anxious uncomfortable, to where I couldn't sit still, and I, no matter which way I turned or moved, it was like I just couldn't get there, you know. And wasn't a TV show that was disturbing me, I was thinking, open hearing what God was saying to me at the same time, even through the show. Do you ever watch a non-religious show and God speaks to you through what you're seeing? Well, I was open for that, but it wasn't really coming. It's like, Lord, what's going on? Well, finally, I just kind of tuned out of the show, and I started taking stock of my physical self, and I realized I'm skipping heartbeats. I could feel it, you know. In fact, I just kind of crossed my arms while I was watching TV and started, I pressed in on the, what is that, a carotid? Carotid. Thank you. I finally got it right this morning. Carotid artery. I was checking. Strong heartbeat, regular heartbeat, and all of a sudden there was one that went by and it didn't beat. And so I thought, that's weird. Hadn't felt that in a long time. So I kept waiting, and sure enough, skipped another heartbeat, and then two good beats and another skipped heartbeat. And I'm thinking, what's going on here? No pain, no tightness, no shortness of breath, no nothing. It's just skipped heartbeats. Now, I've felt that before. But it's been about 1991, which is a fair piece back, right? 25 years or so. And the conditions that I was in when I felt that often weren't good because I was clinically depressed. That means that my anxiety, my emotional self, anger, suppressed anger, had done a work in my body to throw my body chemistry completely out of whack. And for no reason, I remember one day I was sitting in my car in a bank line waiting to make a deposit. Deposits are good things. They're hard to come by, right? So I shouldn't have been nervous or worried about anything. But while I was sitting there waiting my turn, it was on a Friday afternoon, end of the week, paycheck in hand, five cars back, how you inch up a little at a time, listening to the radio, wasn't thinking about anything in particular. All of a sudden, I started having that skipped heartbeat thing. It kind of makes you want to catch your breath, but you're not out of breath. I don't understand how that works, but that's the feeling, okay? And I was going, Lord, what, you know, I don't understand. Well, I didn't ask back then, but last night I was asking, Lord, what's going on? Back then, I was skipping heartbeats because the pros say I was having an anxiety attack or a panic attack. But I wasn't panicked or I wasn't anxious about anything. But my body was responding out of distress because my body chemistry was so messed up. Now, I admit, yesterday, that extra piece of ham and that extra piece of pie could have distressed my physical system, but I don't think it sent me into depression. So I'm trying to understand this, and it's not life-threatening, I don't think. I'm asking the Lord, is this something I need to be worried about? You know, I'm checking. I'm not in pain. No faint. You know how they say you get sometimes if you're having a heart attack, if you don't feel it in your chest, you feel it in your arm. And I was paying attention to all that stuff, but none of that was present. It was just I couldn't get comfortable. I couldn't catch my breath, even though I wasn't short of breath. I couldn't find that place of rest where we were kicking back, just enjoying. Relaxing after the day of busyness, okay? It got me so concerned because after a while I kept having more and more. It's like I'd have two good heartbeats and a skip beat, one heartbeat and a skip heartbeat, and then I'd have five in a row good ones and then one skipped one again, and it wasn't going away, and I was asking. Finally, I just said, Nona, I need you to pause it. She had the clicker, right? So she paused it. And I said, I need you to come and help me. She said, what do you need help with? And I said, I need you to come listen to my chest. Well, that got her attention. And I said, I think I'm having skipped heartbeats, but I want you to verify, okay? So she came over and put her head on my chest, which that was nice. And she was listening, and after just a few seconds, she said, yeah, I think you are having skipped heartbeats. And she began, are you hurting? Are you in pain? Are you going through all the list, you know? And I said, nope, and answered all that. And I said, I don't know what to do about this. It's not going away. And so She got on the phone and called our daughter, who's an RN, who was already in bed, asleep. We woke her up. And she said, I'll come if you want me to. And she said, no, Nona was saying, no, don't get out of bed and come. We got other people. So we called our neighbor, who's an RN. And she came over with her stethoscope and began to ask me all the diagnostic questions. She was looking at me, my color, was I calm, was I panicking, was I weirding out, more than normal, and all that stuff. You know, you go through the whole list. She was doing her job as a nurse and checking me, and she was asking me a lot of questions, and have you ever felt this way? Your color's good, but when is the last time this happened? 1991. You know, it's like, what? It's, I told her the deal, and went through the whole litany of all the information, and it was still happening. She listened and said, yeah, you're right. You're skipping some heartbeats. It wasn't 10 in a row. That's good. I'd been on the floor by then probably. But I wasn't feeling so good. It's not that I felt bad. I can't describe what it felt like. It's like on a roller coaster when you go off the really big one and you're going down. If your heart skips a beat, it's like, I'm out of control. This is out of control. It's kind of like anxiety. So that's, I guess, why they call it an anxiety attack or a panic attack or something. But I had no reason to be in this condition. The last thing that ever crossed my mind was, this is spiritual. I was looking at the physical. I live in the physical. Most of y'all do too. That was a joke kind of, but you know how somebody say, I can't be there today, but I'll be there in spirit, right? Are you sitting on somebody? You got to be careful when they're here in spirit that you don't sit on them, you know? So she's asking me these things, and I'm telling her, and she doesn't show, she's a pro, she doesn't show any alarm. If I told her something really bad, she would have been concerned but not freaking out, you know? So she's good. She's a good nurse. So anyway, in a little while, it still wasn't really settling down very much. So she said, can I pray with you? And I said, absolutely. So I held out my hand. She grabbed my hand and began to pray over me. And started easing up, started not skipping so many beats. And, you know, I started kind of feel a little bit stronger. And of course, Nona was there. She was praying too. They just had a good prayer service over me. And during that time, I was wondering if the thought came to me, is this a spiritual attack? The enemy reaching through the confines of my physical domain that is mine to rule and reign and messing with my body. And I didn't have an answer for that at that point. Well, after she got done praying, I was feeling some better, you know. And she began to share. Well, Nona said, well, what can we pray with you about? And she already knew some stuff, so we started praying about her. Well, she related this. This is what I want to get down to. When she went over to get her, our neighbor, she was on the phone with her daughter, who is a new Christian, fairly new. She thinks that she actually made a genuine decision for Christ. But since she lives in the far reaches of the north, that she hasn't had time to really see any fruit or evidence. You know what I'm saying? Scripture says when you become a new creation, all things become new. You're not the same person anymore. You become something new, unique. And even though you don't know anything about the gospel hardly or anything much of the Bible at all, you suddenly begin to not do things the same way, and that's the fruit of the Spirit. When you become genuinely converted, things change immediately. You don't become this all-wise person. That takes time. You don't know many Bible verses, if any at all. That takes time. But there's something in you that makes you react different, live different. I've heard so many testimonies just over the past 4 or 6 weeks how some people instantly lost their sailor's language. You know what I'm talking about? cussing. They lost it overnight, that quick. Why? Because there was the Holy Spirit in them who put the clamp on that. You know, didn't want to come out. They didn't want to do it, and they didn't have any struggle not doing it. That was God. Another testimony I heard of was a person who had an alcohol problem. From the time that they got converted, they'd never had any desire for another drink of alcohol. That's unusual. But it can happen. That's evidence of a genuine conversion. Back in the day, in some Pentecostal and full gospel churches, they say, well, you're not really saved unless you've given evidence of that by speaking in tongues. That's not in the book. It's in the book that people did that, but that's not a requirement. Amen? And so, but we look for things. This lady didn't ever get to see that because they were separated by much distance. So she couldn't really say. Well, either even if she wasn't born again yet, but she was an awakened soul waiting, you know, the Lord was moving on her, and she already made her profession of some kind, but you don't know if there was a life change. So even if she was still in that condition of awakened soul, or if she was a brand new neophyte Christian who didn't know much of anything, I realized that after I heard what she had to say, that this woman, she's married, but she needed help. Because the story that unfolded is that her husband, who wasn't saved, began to, for whatever reason, I don't know if it was physical abuse, emotional abuse, or whatever, began to really rail on her for her newfound faith, and she had to actually leave her home and go somewhere. And now this guy apparently has enlisted the help of some of his friends, one of which is a witch, black witch, to actually, they think, probably casting a spell on her, to the point where she was driven to the point of calling her mom and saying, I want to die. I think I'm going to commit suicide. What can you do from 1,200 miles away? Well, you can speak encouragement. You can pray. You can, if it's really serious, you could call someone there to intervene, obviously. She didn't feel that she needed to do that at that point. But this woman was under attack, demonic attack, assigned attack by a witch, someone who thought that they were in control of supernatural power. That those folk are really not in control. They can speak things, they can cast spells, they can make tokens and interfere and do all this. It's warfare from the black side, from the dark, you know, Prince of Darkness. But the reality is the Prince of Darkness and his demons will play along with that to the point to where you are so far into it that when the tables are reversed and they realize I don't have any control over this, it's controlling me, then they're almost helpless at that point without divine intervention, without a Christian becoming involved, usually. At least that's my experience, okay? So this guy apparently has had a witch make an assignment on this woman to do her harm because he's mad that she would leave and, you know, all the stuff that goes in with that kind of problem, marital problem. Hating the church, didn't want her to go, blah, blah. So while I was hearing all this story unfold, as the mom, our friend was telling it, I began to understand this is a spiritual attack. And I'm thinking, it's not an attack on me because of this woman. That's a whole separate spiritual attack. And before the night was over, I understood that he was trying to stir me up. He came to, he knew I was preaching today. He wanted me to feel so bad that I would stay home or call in sick or, you know, do whatever, I don't know. If he could, he'd take my life, but he hadn't got that kind of authority. Amen. And I should have snapped to it quicker than I did, but I didn't. I was thinking, you know, I'm out of shape. I'm getting older, blah, blah. There are probably reasons why my heart is skipping beats that are not spiritual. I wouldn't even give it a thought until all the other options were empty, so I turned to the, shouldn't it be the other way around? Shouldn't I have gone to the spiritual side first? And so what if it was natural? I'm already home here at the spiritual. I can call that into order if I'd gone there first. Amen? Well, as this thing kept unfolding, we found out that it wasn't only her, but it was her brother, this woman's son, her child. Okay, I thought it was a brother. All right, who was in a wreck some time back and has had suffered a head trauma. And because of that head trauma, his personality has changed to a certain degree, and he's way angry all the time. That could be a physiological reaction from the wreck, or there could be something going on spiritually that has piggybacked in on that injury and is causing him no end of harm. He's not a Christian at all. We know that, right? So the devil's messing not only with this woman, the daughter of our friend, but also her son, physically and probably spiritually as well. There's an all-out attack going on. And the Lord helped me to understand that he bit off more than he could chew here. I'll tell you why. I would never have known about this woman or her son except that he was messing with me, and we called for help from someone who had knowledge of this issue in their lives, in their family life. Now, the devil, he can't see in the future too good. Okay? He knows a few things, but they're not sure. It's mostly what he's figuring out would probably be. And if he speaks it into your life and you begin to dwell on it, then it comes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And it looks like he knows the future, but he really doesn't. That makes sense? All right. So here he is. He's messing with Rob. Tomorrow's Sunday. You know, he's trying to mess with me. I call a friend who has bigger problems than that in her family. She comes over and we talk about it, and we start warfare praying over this daughter, the spirit that's been attacking her, the witch that's been involved, and all the friends of the husband who are making assignments and pointing spiritual attack on her because she's a Christian, a new Christian. Now, we can intercede on her behalf that way because she doesn't know much at all. And she hadn't done anything that opened the door to them except have a marriage relationship with an unsaved person who's vindictive and ready to unleash devils through his friends. So she's not owning the ground that the enemy's trying to take here. Do you understand what I'm saying? He's an interloper. He's the one who's butting in, and he has no right to be there. We as intercessors understood that, and we began to stand in the gap. There was a breach in her wall. We stood in that hole that the enemy was made, and we cut off access. We rebuked the enemy. In fact, we even asked the Lord to send his angels or speak the word to turn that attack back on the enemy himself, that the pitfalls he's made would spring on himself, that the quagmires and the faulty thinking and the confusion, the depression and all that would spring back on the enemy himself. And bring this woman to her senses where she could think straight, where she could even get a word or whatever of instruction and understanding of the authority that's in her and those kind of things. When we began to start praying like that, our friend's phone rang, and it was her. But we were still praying, so she said, answered it and said, Can I call you right back? And she said, yeah. So hung up the phone. We finished our warfare praying and did some more kind of ministry stuff there, but for a few minutes. And then she left and went home and called her daughter back. Come to find out that while we were praying, she got a call from somebody up there close by that gave her a word. It was a Christian. I don't know anything about, maybe they were at the church where she got saved, or I don't have a clue, but it was a prophetic woman called her and said, right now there's a man and woman praying for you. You don't have to worry. Things are going to be okay. It's going to work out. And when she and her mom talked, she wasn't thinking those kind of things anymore, apparently. And her mind had gotten clear and not chaotic, and she wasn't under attack anymore. She wasn't feeling anything. I mean, the enemy was cut off. She was encased in a fortress. There was a hedge built around her. All kind of things that we prayed about that. And it, with that in mind, and the confirmation that there was an effective intercession going on, also began to believe for the stuff that we prayed against the enemy himself, that the things were springing back on him, that his plans and his stuff were coming to nothing, and et cetera, et cetera. And that this woman also told her, said, I don't know what the situation is at your home, but you don't need to go back to your home. She didn't know that they were separated, that there was a witch and all that involved and stuff. She didn't know any of that. She just said, the Lord says, don't go back to your house. Don't go back to your home. Now, how that's going to work out in the future, I do not know. I don't have that. Lord didn't show me that. But God is real. The spirits are real. Warfare is real. Now, by the time we finished that warfare praying, I was back at 100%. I didn't feel bad. I felt strong, which I'm not physically, but I felt strong in the spirit for sure, and that had rule and reign over my physical. Do you understand? There, that domain of ours that includes heaven can set the order of the day in the natural. Now, I said all that to tell you, to just relate a story of the reality of it, and now I want to go to the scriptures for a moment and talk about the dominion that we have. You already know it. I'm not going to show this on the board. There'll be some that I call out to you, Amy. This is not one because everybody pretty much knows. In the garden, we know that Adam and Eve had dominion. They had rule and reign over the earth, okay? Jesus said it in chapter 1, verse 26 through 28. God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them, because he knew there was going to be more than one, man, male and female, have dominion, that means rule and reign. A king has dominion over his domain, the kingdom that's his. Amen. Well, guess how big is the kingdom of the Son of Man, the King of Kings? It's all of it. From the third heaven to the second heaven to our heaven to the earth and under the earth, the whole universe is his. He is the King of all kings. His dominion is creation itself. Okay? Have you plugged into that lately? Have you attached yourself to that kind of power and that kind of authority? He lives in you. It's possible to do that. All right, so he's given dominion over the fish of the sea, birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, basically, is what it says. That's our domain, or was. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion. And so there's no wild animal that, at that point in time, when Adam and Eve were there, that could rise up against them. Wouldn't any really need to, because they were obedient and in line with God and all that stuff too, even creation was, until sin entered the world. But man had the authority to subdue the entire domain, all of earth. But when he gave into sin and ate the forbidden fruit, the scripture says, even Satan tells Jesus that when Jesus was tempted, he said, all these things, he showed him in one moment all the kingdoms of the earth and said, all these things I'll give to you because I have the authority, I have the dominion over them. They are mine to give to whom I will. Now, Jesus didn't rebuke him for that remark. I think it was true. We laid down or gave away our authority in the earth, in fact, our birthright, kind of like Esau, for a peek at what it's like to know good from bad, tree of knowledge of good and evil. We did that in the garden. It was Satan's from that point until Christ. He's called the prince of the power of the air. This is not his domain. It's our domain. So why does he get to be prince and not me? And not you. because we gave it away. He had our permission. And he took it and more. He wants it all. And the reason, I'm not even going to go there, but the reason was that he wants worship. He told that. He said, I'll give you all that stuff that quick if you'll bow down and worship me. That's what he's been wanting from the beginning. And I'm not here to preach about the enemy. That would be a good sermon sometime to unfold everything that the Word has to say about his agenda and how he came to the place where sin was found in him and all that. Even what his responsibilities were as a cherubim, one of the cherubim in heaven. But we're not going to do that today. All right? It says in Psalm 8, 4 and 5, what is man that you're mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. That's why we were created, to have dominion and rule and reign. You have put all things under his feet before the fall. After the fall, it wasn't that way. In fact, we were under curse. And so everyone that's been born as a human since the fall has entered in the world. Even David said in one of his psalms, it says, I was born in sin. Doesn't mean that his mother had an affair and he was a result or something like that. No, it wasn't because she sinned. It's because as a human being, and you're born as a natural man, natural woman, you're born in sin. It's the curse. Long story short, Jesus came and he died on that cross. He lived a perfect life. He was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Because of his life and because of his vicarious death and the blood that he shed, we can enjoy freedom. We can enjoy a rebirth to where we're no longer natural men and women, boys and girls. We become supernatural because Holy Spirit now lives in us. But it just doesn't change our destination of heaven instead of hell. When Jesus said, "It is finished," on the cross, he wasn't just talking about his mission of shedding pure blood that would satisfy the wages of sin for everyone on the face of the earth. That was huge just in itself. He was talking about a lot more than that. He was talking about a restoration of dominion, rule, and reign for us in this world, this fallen world, that we have to contend with every day. God releases his power in the earthly realm in response to redeemed humans calling on him to do so through our worship and our praying, especially intercession. The Spirit moves in response to what God's people say and what they do. He ordained us to rule the earth forever through partnership with Jesus as a bride filled with adoring obedience. So when we come into a place like this, even when it's hard to break through in our praise and our worship, the whole idea is to draw near, to have that veil parted to where we can sense his nearness and his presence. And he has obviously permission to move in our lives however he wants to. I hope you come in with that kind of attitude, right? That mindset. I'm coming to meet with the King of Kings. And he loves me so much, I'm willing to throw my hands wide open and say, "Here, take me. Wherever you want, whatever you need to do in my life, do it. Whatever dark crevice in my heart that I want to keep secret, you invade that space and make it into light." And with an attitude like that, where you present yourself as a living sacrifice before the King of Kings, he can't help but move. He can't help but part the veil, as it were, of our mortal flesh. Where 1 Corinthians says we only see through a glass darkly. We can see forms and stuff, but we don't really understand what's going on over there. It's faith issue right now, right? Well, when you get in that place before the Lord with that kind of attitude and you begin to lift your voice up, the manifest presence of the King that's on the throne begins to pull back the veil to let some of his glory shine through, his majesty, his greatness, his mercy, his everything that he is begins to shine through. And the weird thing about it is I can have that kind of vision back there or up here, doesn't matter, we're in the building. I can see that in my mind's eye by faith and be having a meltdown and the person next to me doesn't even have a clue what's going on. I'm just waiting to get out of here so I can go eat some more of that dressing that I had yesterday. Taking too long. Do we have to sing that same chorus over 10 times? I mean, isn't 8 times enough? It's kind of like soaking in the tub. Do you take a shower or a tub bath? I take a shower because it's easier. It's hard to get up after I get down. Okay. But a tub bath's really good for me. You know why? Because you spend more time in a tub bath than you do a shower. That's one reason why I don't take them, because I think I don't have enough time. I got other things I need to do. But to be honest with you, when you soak in the tub, all the hard skin on you starts to soften. It mollifies the flesh. Makes it pliable. In the supernatural, when you immerse yourself in the living water that's available and flowing freely, the more time you spend there, the more soft your heart gets. Because having a hardened heart is not good for you, in the natural or the spiritual. Skipped heartbeats. How many spiritual skipped heartbeats have you had this week? Because your heart was so hardened in that area, I have to put up with this person at work or even at home. I have to put up with this, you know, and really what's going on in the spiritual realm is you're missing the abundant life. You're missing the pleasures of the nearness of God. God's nowhere to be found at that point because you got something against somebody. And what does he say about that if you come to the altar to worship? Don't even bother to come worship me in that frame of mind. Leave your gift at the altar and go and make peace. Or try. It's a two-way street. If they don't want to, hey, you did your part. But you might as well not even seek my face until that's happened, because it ain't, you're not going to see, not going to be there. I will not open the veil to your rock-hard heart. Why don't you soak in the river a little while? Because my conviction has been coming all week long, and you haven't been listening. Therefore, you need to soften up that hardened heart a little bit and let my spirit get through to you. Be obedient and then watch the blessings flow again. The presence. Amen. Today's a new day. His mercies are new every day. If he convicts you of sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you of that sin, to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And restoration's always better than it was in the beginning. Always. We already know about Adam and Eve and what they gave away. We also know pretty much, I think, about the restoration of our dominion. But since we're still living in a fallen world, and since I'm still not 100% new here, my spirit is brand new. It's a forever thing. Well, you know, my spirit is joined to the Holy Spirit. That's not going to change. Spirit doesn't change so much. It's what the effect of that living water that's coming out of the throne of God in my heart has in my life, in my soul. What I think, how I feel, the decisions I make or don't make, the ones I should and I don't. That's a sin too, by the way, you know. They call that sins of omission. So I get sin coming and going, you know. Things I do, but things I don't do. You do too. And some of them don't seem so serious. That's why I blow them off, you know. Somebody comes across your mind, the Lord brings somebody across your mind, and you don't call them, you don't text them. I'm busy. What if it was that woman's daughter who just fell on the floor with a massive migraine? Then she never has migraines, but she's being attacked spiritually. And I was supposed to call, but I didn't. I blew that off because I got things to do over here. It could be a matter of life and death, even. Somebody waiting to blow themselves away, except that you call on the phone. You don't even know they're in that kind of shape. Is that not a sin? When the Lord prompts you and you don't respond? When he tells you to come up here to praise and worship, but you're stubborn and you go back and stand up, at least you're standing up, and you're holding on to the back seat with white knuckles because ain't nothing moving me. I ain't going. You can't make me. I shall not be moved. What is it? I'll leave the Lord. You can define what it is between you and him. All right. Well, the enemy has no power. He does have power, but it's only the power we give him, right? You understand that? His teeth are pulled. All he's got is a big roar and something that'll try to make you back down, because if you'll back down, then he can stay where he is or advance even further. But if we set it down, if we make the statement, if we drive a stake in the sand, he can't pass that. He has no authority. And the reason is because God has given me back my authority over my domain. And he can buck it, but he can't win. All right? There's something called exousia. Sometimes the Bible translates that word in the New Testament as authority. When Jesus was being tempted, that's exactly what the devil said in Luke 4:6. He said, and the devil said to him, all this authority I will give to you and their glory of all these cities, you know. For this has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I wish. I'll give you all the authority. What's the last thing that God said in Matthew 28 is before he lifted off the earth to go back to the Father? After the crucifixion and resurrection, after 40 days on earth, he said, what did he say about authority? You remember? All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. But when the devil came to him, he didn't have it. This is something he won back at the cross. And so really what was happening is the devil had the authority, not to give him the authority. He gave him authority to tempt Jesus into taking a shortcut to something that was already going to be his. But what kind of calamity and disaster would that have accomplished in the earth for God to bow down and worship Satan? We would be toast right now. I don't even know if we'd be standing here anymore. I mean, that brings up a question. Could Jesus have failed as a man? He came here to show us the way as a man. He didn't do anything on his own initiative. We talked about that this morning in our class. He said, only do what I see the Father doing. So did Jesus have the power to heal? No. That's unthinkable, really. But the honest truth is, he laid that down. He laid it. Scripture says, he laid that down. His Godhood, his omniscience. He didn't know everything. He couldn't do all things. He couldn't be in more than one place at a time, like your life demands on you sometimes. Need you to be in two places or more at the same time. Even Jesus didn't have that capability anymore as a man. And he was there for the reason for the express purpose. Well, there's too many things that he was going to accomplish in his life. One of the main things was to show us. The scripture says in 2 Corinthians, he was the last Adam. Through the first Adam came death. Through the last Adam came life. But he did it as a man. He did it to show us that it is possible to live a sinless life once you're infilled with Holy Spirit like he was. He was baptized in the Holy Spirit, right? At his water baptism. Two baptisms happened that day under the hands of John the Baptist. He got water baptized to show the way, but he didn't do it because he had any sin that needed forgiven, right? He was sinless. In fact, as John said, I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you. And he said, no, let us do this to fulfill all righteousness. He got water baptized to show us the way of righteousness. But then the verbiage of the Greek says, when he came up out of the water, that was over. But that wasn't all that was on the table for today. You know, the heavens opened, Holy Spirit descended and lit on him like a dove. Father spoke out of heaven, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. et cetera, et cetera, baptism of the Holy Spirit. He didn't do one miracle. He didn't do any ministry until he was empowered by the presence of Holy Spirit on his life. And the scripture says, coming out of that, the Spirit drove him into the wilderness to be tested. But he was equipped and ready for that because he had Holy Spirit. That's our model. That is why when he said it is finished, then he sealed the deal, not just on our salvation, our empowerment, our rights as sons of God, the inheritance, the blessing, the presence of God. Everything is now ours to go back and pick up the dominion mandate that was on mankind's person in the garden. Rule and reign. Be fruitful. Multiply. Take control. So last night, when it began to dawn on me that this was not a physical thing, there was something in me that said, And then when I found out it wasn't just me, but this woman and her son even, we prayed over both of them, then it suddenly occurred to me, you know, the enemy bit off way more than he could chew. And he's stupid because he's messing with me. I'm nothing special, y'all. I'm just a born-again believer, okay? I'm nothing special, but he's messing with me because he wants to do me harm and interrupt and, you know, and get me just off on a wild goose chase or whatever, make me have chaotic thinking where I couldn't prepare and all that. Actually, I was preparing as this thing unfolded. But what he didn't realize is that when we called for the obvious person to get help, she was asleep, and we didn't want her to get out of bed and come. She's had a hard day, okay? So what did we do? We turned to a neighbor who had the skills that we needed, not knowing that she had her own list of things that she needed a miracle in on behalf of her daughter and grandson, right? Devil didn't know that. He's messing with me. We call in a friend that's unexpected. Shouldn't have gone that way, but it did. She came in with a bigger list, and we did. We took care of all of it. He didn't want that. He didn't need that. That was not his plan. He bit off way more than he could chew on that one. And he lost a lot more ground than he wanted to. More ground than he even thought he would if it ever came to that. If he could have got me down, you know, I'd been in an emergency room all night and, you know, trying to wait, and they would say, I don't see anything wrong. It's psychosomatic. You hear me? They'll tell you your mind is inventing it all. That wasn't true. That can happen. And that's probably what they would have said because they totally discount the spiritual realm. You can't measure that. You can't quantify that. You can't test that. You got no remedies for that. I don't want a remedy for that one, God. Thank you. I want to be a spiritual man. I want to operate in the spirit. The enemy messed up. And he knew it as soon as we uncorked on him. I love doing that. Ephesians 6:12 says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers in heavenly places. And we're equipped for that. Take up the whole armor of God. That doesn't mean the armor that God furnishes you. That means it's his armor. And it fits perfectly, y'all. Why? Because God's in you. Amen? And having done all to stand, take a stand. Taking the shield of faith, quenching all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. You are never more powerful in your prayer than when you start quoting scripture and use it against the issue. That is the sharpest and most devastating weapon that can be leveled against your enemy. You know, whatever problems you're faced with, there's a result of several factors in your life working together. ultimately, there's always something at the root of it that wants to take you down. And really, that is the source. That's the place where you need to concentrate your warfare. Not against the fact that you don't have enough money to pay the bill. That's a symptom of something deeper. Not that you can't ever get a word in edgewise because you're always shouted down at whenever you're in the presence of this family member and they can't even reason well within themselves and all that stuff. You don't have to fight the fight to get schooled and caught up on current affairs to try to deal with whatever issues at hand with them. It won't work anyway. They're not listening to you. They're already thinking about what they're going to say when you know. It's something deeper. That's a symptom. Go deeper. Go and think about that spirit that brings chaotic thinking, that brings stubbornness of heart, that brings a deceptive spirit that can come and tell them anything that, you know, this is white. And they will attest to death that this is white. Why? Because it's not what they think and not their perception even. It's demonically driven. But somehow, in some reason, they have that openness in their heart to have that kind of spirit that will be contentious, will argue with a fence post until the fence post rots away. And they're probably causing it to rot away quicker just by spewing. All right? You know people like that? Are you one? There's hope. There's a cure. We just want to deal with the symptom. Just get the noise out of my ear. I'm not going over there anymore. That's running from a fight. But you're not fighting them, I hope. Fighting the spirit behind that's doing all this. You understand? Pray, Lord, show me. Like I should have done last night at the beginning. Lord, why have I got skipped heartbeats? It's crazy. It hadn't happened in 21 years, and I was really messed up back then physically. My body was in shambles. I had to get medicine just to get me lined out. And then after I got off that medicine, I could live a normal life after that. And plus, I got schooled, too. That's always good. Doing the medicine without having any understanding of why you got that way in the first place, self-defeating. You're going to end up back in the same boat or worse. Right? Why didn't I think of that last night? Say, Lord, this is not normal. This is not me. Show me. Open my eyes. Open my heart. Talk to me. What is going on here? He finally did. I didn't pray that prayer, but, you know, I'm slow. Y'all are too. I'm not alone in my confession. Demonic oppression can be strong or weak. It can be so I don't even know the right word to use, persistent in your life. When the enemy wants to be quiet and covert, he'll just pick something small and he'll worm it, he'll screw it in, he'll, you know, itch and scratch and hurt, and pretty soon you got a sore. And, you know, he'll step it up or back it off and just so that you won't notice it's him. You think it's just living the life in a fallen world at best. If it's not my fault altogether, you know, he's an accuser of the brethren, right? So instead of having to endure all that, the longer he goes and it's nothing major. I don't need to give it my full attention, I think. It's just a hassle. But he wears you down. He makes you crazy with the little stuff. And when the time is right, he thinks, then you get bombarded with something big. And lo and behold, I got no feet and no knees that are strong enough to stand. The last thing on my mind is turning to a spiritual answer. You with me? Gee, if I would pay attention to the little stuff and not let him grind on me and grind me down and wear me down and all of that stuff, I just don't recognize it's him. I ought to spend, you know, I know somebody that does know. Why don't I plug in with him more often to find these kind of things out? Then I would be in shape to take on whatever. Lastly, do not Hebrews 6:12. Do not become sluggish, but through faith and patience inherit the promises. That's a tough scripture to stomach. Let me say it again. Do not become sluggish, but through faith and patience inherit the promises. And what does that tell you? It's a process. God's given you a promise. Hallelujah. That's good. That's great. It sets our sights on things above and not things below. That's good. Get your mind on the spiritual and not on the earthly. But to get to that promise, I got to slog through a bunch of crud on the earth. Amen? Bogs, mire. People that want to hold me down or keep me down. Resistance from the enemy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's a process. And so how does he say? How do you make that attack? Do you just run out and go straight for the promise and take that promise to yourself? No. Faith and patience will inherit, cause you to inherit the promises. When your inheritance comes, it's perfect. It's in right order. It's in the perfection of time in God's view. How many times have people run out? They got the promise. They know the vision. They run out and they try to make it happen all by natural means, and it's not God at all. They're rushing the process. There is no process. I'm going to start this ministry. I'm going to buy that jet. I'm going to start, paying all this money, your entire life savings on something that will help you to get the promise that God said. And he's not looking to give you the promise only. He wants to give you the process as well. How can you learn how to fight if you never have a battle? How can you learn to stand strong if you've never been pressed or pushed down or laid on your back with an illness, maybe even a terminal disease? How can you learn to prize the glory of God if you never see it? When he wants to come to you, fourth stage cancer, and heal you, have it drop off in the floor, in a Holy Ghost meeting where the preacher didn't even get to preach. It was all just worship and presence. But you got to experience something that you never would have had if you hadn't had that tumor. Something that we'll never forget. Something that will, that experience will be yours from now in eternity. In fact, that will be one of many in your life that you overcome the evil one, because even in the last days it says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony. That's what's going to make you strong, not working the promise. It's the process. That's where you get equipped. The command of faith doesn't always bring instant results. There was a chance, possibility, and I knew that, but it doesn't keep me from praying anyway. I knew last night when we began to pray, we may not see any answers to this for a while. So, Lord, I'm asking the Lord, do we need to make this a long-term prayer? Because, flirting with the occult or being assaulted by the occult at someone else's behest, that's no light thing. You need to take care of business. You need to be aware. Do we need to be a long-term intercessor on behalf of this woman? The answer was yes, even though, and I didn't expect to see any results. I don't know. I knew she called before we were done praying. It was in the midst of a prayer. And she said, oh, that's her now. And I thought to myself instantly, she's already got an answer. But I didn't know for sure. We finished, we did the rest of our thing. And lo and behold, 10 minutes later, after she got back home and called, she found out all the answer to that. That was so cool. That's God. What if I didn't get that confirmation? Did it make it any less real? What if she didn't call? Would I lose any hope? I hope not. Would I stay strong in the assignment? I hope so. It's a process. You walk by faith. We walk by faith. And even when the faith doesn't cause an instant answer, is that permission for you to quit? No. How long you been praying for somebody that 10 years, 15 years, still don't know the Lord yet, that you know of? I mean, there's no visible, and their confession's still bad, and they still do all the weird, bad stuff. Does that mean you can quit? Nope. So, I'm done with preaching. But I want you to stand. And I got a couple of questions to throw at you, and I want you to do business with God this morning. Can you put on something soft and quiet? All right, here's the first question. Keep your feet on the floor, because they're about to be stepped on. What's the last thing God told you to do that you hadn't done yet? If you have no clue right now, and you're in your, guys, if you're in your nothing box, get out of your nothing box and ask Him flat out, Lord, what's the last thing you told me to do that I haven't done yet? You already know what it is anyway. It came to mind that quick, usually, for most people. So what's standing in the way of you accomplishing or just putting your hand to what He said to do, and you haven't done it yet? What's causing you to balk? Is it stubbornness? Is it unbelief? Is it, you know, too expensive? Is it too out of the, it's a hassle, Lord. I'm not going to inconvenience myself that bad. Especially for them, they don't even deserve it anyway. Well, guess what? You didn't deserve it anyway either, but He moved in your behalf, right? You're where you are today because you didn't deserve it, and He had mercy on you. How about this currency of mercy that we've been hearing about? How about spending a little of that currency on somebody or something that you've refused to do for whatever reason? That's one question. Second question, what promise is there in your life that you've been chasing and not waiting on God to fulfill as an inheritance, as your inheritance? If you're trying to make it happen, then you're doing all kind of dead works. We just took a look at that in class this morning, elementary principles. It says repent from dead works. That's when you initiate, you supply, you figure it out, and you try to do something for God. Please don't do that. Call on Him and allow Him to do it through you. Amen. So what are you chasing that He said is yours? It's got your name on it, but you don't have it in your hands yet. Are you going to chase Him down and take it out of time and out of order? Sometimes He wants us to wrestle Him for it. We talked about that before. But you'll know the time and the place to do that. Amen. So those two things, and that's all I'm going to require of you. Bow your heads, get before the Lord. Turn up the music just a little. Give us some ambiance or whatever. Do business with God. Answer that question. Make a commitment to Him to do what He said to do that you've been balking on all this time. And then pray to Him for grace to put down your efforts to obtain the promise. The only effort you need to apply is to chase after God. Persist, press into His presence like this morning. Follow hard after Him. He'll bring it to pass. Lord, we bless Your holy name. We give You thanks for Your loving kindness that's new every day. I pray in Jesus' name that You would grant us all the persistence and the endurance to follow hard after You all of our days. That we would count ourselves as nothing except a servant of the Most High God. And that we would press into You just like Jesus pressed into You. We don't do anything of our own initiative except that we see You already doing it. We pray for that spirit of revelation to come, to give us eyes to see, ears to hear what You're saying to us individually as families and even as this church. But Father, let us not try to take up something that's not ours to handle. May we just submit to You and allow You to accomplish it in Your perfect timing and in the way that You want to. That what the result will last for eternity and not just for the time that we have here on this earth that's so brief. Father, we glorify Your name. We lift You high and exalt You because it's Your rightful place. There's none beside You and none over you. You are lifted high above every principality, far beyond. And we give you the glory and honor. Pray, O God, that you would grant safety to our pastors who are away, that they would return refreshed, that they would be full of your Spirit, and that you had spoken to them greatly while they've been away about what's on your heart and your mind. Lord, I pray for every pastor that's in this house, that you would grant them wisdom, that you would soften their hearts, Lord, for the charges that you have placed under them. And, oh God, that we might see your manifest presence in the lives of this people. And as we answer your call together, may we take high ground that has been unavailable in the past, but now because of the new day that we're in, that we would march into triumphantly and victoriously to the glory of God and the furtherance of your kingdom, O God. Pray, O God, that we would be able to see eternal things happen because we were patient to receive the inheritance of the promise that you are giving us. I speak blessing on these, O God, and I pray the rest of the days of this week that you would grant us a sense of your immediate presence with us. May our ears be unstopped from the noise of the world to hear your slightest whisper, and that our desire would be to step out with you in lockstep with the Spirit, not running ahead and not lagging behind. I pray for the commitments that have been made during this time of invitation, that the things that have been put off or forgotten or ignored, Lord, would now become the most important thing that we can do, to be obedient to you. I bless your name, O God, and I thank you for your loving kindness and your presence with us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sorry. Oh, new member. Sorry. Can we hold on? You're already up, so we're going to ask you to come forward here in just a minute, if I can find my notes. Yeah, Geneva. Are you? Come. This lady, Geneva Gustam, has wanted to be joined to our body, and that's good. We want to invite the pastors, elders, please come up. Please come right here. We're going to pray for you and welcome you. Geneva, glad you're here. Okay, members, is there anyone else who wants to join? It's the only one that I almost knew about. I almost forgot, I'm sorry. That's why my wife is there to help me have a brain. Leaders, I'm going to see members, please come forward. We're going to pray together. Come around. Joe, come on in. Fill the hole. Fill in gaps. Father, we just thank you for Geneva's life. I thank you for the giftings that you placed in her, your presence in her, Lord. She's a treasure that we haven't been able to experience yet. But because you're in her, Lord, it's just going to erupt in sweetness and beauty because of who you are in her. And I thank you for the gift that you're given to this body. But Father, also, we want to thank you for the opportunity as a body to interact with her and to shower her with blessings that you give to us, Lord, that we might be unified, that we press into your presence together, that we might see your glory in each other and in the midst of the tabernacle that you've made here. Lord, we just bless her and say that the covenant that we make with her now is to love her as you have loved us. The covenant that we make now, Lord, is one of unity, where there could be nothing that would drive her away from your love or from ours. And Father, in Jesus' name, we pray that the reciprocation of that coming from her to us would be the same. Bless her going in. Bless her coming out. Grant her wisdom. Grant her knowledge. Grant her a heart that yearns to follow hard after you. And Lord, indeed, may that be upon us all this morning. We just thank you in Jesus' name, and we say welcome to Geneva in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Have a good day. If you come into class tonight, don't come to Song of Solomon.
You were talking to me.